Islam was peace and love. Hotep got a little caught up listening to Sabir Bey show. So big up Sabir. Islam to all the Moors worldwide. You already know. It's Canaan Land Moors, the 8th of July, 2014. Solving the Negro problem. Only as it could be solved. Right? Solving the Negro problem only as it could be solved. We actually got some questions this week, so we're going to hit those up. And once again, Islam to all the Moors online, and as well, all the Moors that are newly acquainted with the concept of Moorish nationality and birthrights. So Islam to you, and you know, all the active Moors, you already know, you're probably going to catch the upload of this because you're doing something. So we're going to start today with reading a little bit of the divine warning by the Prophet Noble Drew Ali, so we could understand, right, that in that time there was this problem. Okay. So he's speaking from a perspective of back then, right? So 1913 to 1929, right? But then everything that he's relaying to the people are things that we're seeing going on today, right? And we're gonna speak about a few people today who were in their ignorant state of mind accepting of the fact that they're Negroes, right? But their speech and how they, you know, delivered their message is right in line with what Noble Drew Ali is saying. And again, it was during the same time period, right? So a divine warning by the Prophet. If you don't have this, you could go online and get it. It's just information about Noble Drew Ali that's out there, that in reality, everybody should know something about Noble Drew Ali, just like they know about everybody else, right? We should be able to just hit them with questions, bam, 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 and they're just answering, just like they answer with anything else, right? So this is accessible information. This is not information that you have to go to the temple and get and all that. You just Google it and come up. Divine warning by the Prophet for the nation. It'll come up. There's no fraudulent versions. There's no versions that somebody changed and then you have to, well, did he really say this and all that, right? All these are articles that were in the Moorish Guide newspaper. So this is stuff that can't be tampered with, per se, right? Because it's public record. So once it goes out in the public record, like what it is what it is. Anything that comes after has to either say that that's void, right? Or whatever's there stands. So the divine warning by the Prophet for the nation that was sent out in the national newspaper that the Moors had during Noble Drew Ali's time, that you don't see it anymore, you know, but you might see something as far as literature, right? Which would prove that Moor who has that publication, whether it's newsprint, newsletter, online website, whatever, right? You know that they're taking a step in the right direction because, you know, Noble Drew Ali said that we have to be our own publishers, right? That was a standard. We're producing our own stuff, right? As far as literature is concerned. So we're going to start at, you who doubt whether I, the Prophet, and my principles are right for the redemption of my people, go to those that know law in the city hall and among the officials in your government and ask them under an intelligent tone, and they will be glad to render you a favorable reply, for they are glad to see me bring you out of darkness into light. All right? Glad to see you bring you out of darkness into light. And just so everybody knows, speaking about this, right? Ask them in an intelligent tone, and they would render you a favorable reply. So remember a couple of classes ago, we were talking about Brother Amari, and then he, you know, said stuff about what happened when he went to the border or whatever, right? So we'll just let you know that he got a response from them, right? We'll just let you know that. And then he'll update everything else that's going on, right? And, you know, they were glad to render him a favorable reply. Right, they were glad to render him a favorable reply. Like he got a personal reach out. He got a personal reach out. Right? Because he dealt with them in an intelligent tone. Right? Because, you know, that Noble Drew Ali said, so, you know, we just do that. And then the funny thing that when you do things that Noble Drew Ali said, it actually goes the way that it's supposed to go. When you actually do what Noble Drew Ali said, you realize that stuff actually goes how it's supposed to go when you do what Noble Drew Ali said. Right? Money doesn't make the man. Right? So gold, silver, fiat, energy, whatever. Right? Money, quote unquote. Right? So forget about stacking up gold and silver and all that stuff, right? In what people's concept is like, yeah, you know, have more gold and silver than water, right? No, have more water than gold and silver, please, right? Money doesn't make the man. It is free national standards and power that makes a man and a nation, right? Now remember, when you go to Circle 7, and you read the Circle 7, you find out that power is an illusion. So really, it's free national standards that make a man. And what does it make a man? It makes a man 5/5 instead of 1/5, 2/5, 3/5, 4/5 of a human being. Okay? So he knew exactly what he's talking about. Right? The wealth of all national governments, right, so not corporate governments, not commonwealths and whatever, right? National government. Specific. National government, the wealth of all national governments, gold and silver and commerce, belong to the citizens alone. And without your national citizenship by name and principle, you have no true wealth. And I am hereby calling on all true citizens that stand for a national free government and the enforcement of the Constitution to help me in my great missionary work. Because I need all support from all true American citizens of the United States of America. Not the United States, not the U.S., not the U.S.A., the United States of America. Right? Because we're American, so we're part of this landmass called the Americas. Help me to save my people who have fallen from the constitutional laws of the government. Help me. So which means that he's been doing this. And obviously he's not, you know, so he's asking for assistance from back then. And then there's people who's watching this that, you know, majority of them, they just got into more science. Ain't but 10 years tops, right? 10 years? That's all the moral science that we got. 10 years. Noble Drew Ali came 100 years ago, and all we have is 10 years practice out of 100 years. Right? So he's saying help him. Right? Help him to do this work that has to be done. You're not help Cujo. Because trust me, the fiat or whatever that you give is going right back to the prophet for him to do what has to get done. Right? Because you already know, you know, I have a slave ship that I go to. So, right? That's life. Everything else goes to the prophet. Everything else goes to the prophet. Just because if I don't give it to him, it's going to burn up in my pocket. And burning pockets, you don't want. Right? Especially not right now. You don't want burning pockets right now. Help me to save my people. So, right? Help him to save them. So obviously they have serious issues. This is back then. Same serious issues that the people are talking about, write books about right now, you know what I mean? Getting grants and all that type of stuff. You know, get big building and all that for some repetitive situation that we didn't learn since 1913. Why? Because we didn't listen to this guy with the funny hat and they say Islam and they dress like Arabs, so we don't listen to them because they're just, that's a circus. And they go over here to these crazy people, right, that sell them out and get paid to sell them out, but then they still want to continue playing, right? So Nobuju Ali came and he was specific that there's a problem. And the only way that the problem will be solved is if we help him. Because we have obligation to help our brother and sister when they're in adversity. Now, if you put your hand out, man drowning, and he doesn't put his hand, don't go diving in and all that type of stuff, right? Because he'll panic and kill you, right? So we'll hit up a couple of these questions and then go from there. So we got sent. So first question, Kalani Asad Il. Could you cover some info on steps taken to travel internationally with the use of U.S. or Canadian passport? Well, basically with regard to the jurisdiction that has occupied and knowing their tendencies and knowing what they do and all that stuff, you know, you reserve your rights on it and, you know, keep that so-called corporate construct name clean on their side, right? Because if you're gonna under threat, duress, and coercion say that that's you, then that better be clean. That better have no gun from, you know, 20 years ago on it, and then you want to go travel, right? On another level, you know, you proclaim your nationality and you as the individual, right? You as the individual, it has nothing to do with anybody else but yourself. You as the individual trying the nationality card and see how far you get. So it's really about activity, right? Like we showed, you know, receipts or whatever, you know, people have been to court out here. We use our nationality card on that level. Internationally, we haven't tried it yet, you know what I mean? But there's people who have tried it, that got on planes and stuff like that with nationality card. That said, they're Moorish American, right? So it's not something that, you know, we'll count out, right? It's not something that we'll say, well, because of the threat, we won't, whatever, but it's something that people have done. And the people who have done it, they did it based on where they were in their mind frame, or even on paperwork. The people who use paperwork go cross borders outside of the jurisdiction of the United States, Canada, South America, right? But you know, it's not like those people who are doing that are, you know, trying something to see if it works. You know what I mean? Like, they're Moors, that's their stuff, and they're going through whatever gate or whatever that somebody has there. Because that's what it is. If you don't want it, then, all right, like, I'll deal with it because, you know, it's my situation, right? Of however they dealt with it. You know what I'm saying? So if you have to get, you know, quote unquote passport, license or whatever like that, you know, I mean, you know, you obviously understand that it's a fraud. So if it's a fraud, you reserve your rights, right? Under threat, duress, and coercion, because we're under occupation in our own land. And, you know, use the instrument. But just remember that don't call none of the stuff that you're using yours. That's always the democracy's instrument. That's always the foreign European colonizer's instrument that you're using. It's never, ever, 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 ever supposed to be called my license. Well, I'm a Moor, but, you know, if I put Moor on my license, would I be able to drive? Like, that's crazy talking. Don't even talk like that. Because you'll definitely injure yourself and then come and blame the information. Right? Now, again, same thing with the driver's questions, right? The travel and all that stuff. That's not what Moorish nationality is about. That's sovereignty demonstration. If you're into Moorish science 2 years, right? And the things that you have studied most within the realm of Moorish science is right to travel, claiming house or claiming property, and something to do with taxes, right? You're probably getting injured or about to get injured because you've taken a sliver of what this is about and try to make it look like, you know, a plank of wood or whatever. Right? And the individuals who receive documents that have, you know, all rights reserved on them or whatever like that, they know. Right? You know what I mean? Like, I had a banker tell me, yeah, I reserve my rights too, just like how you do that. Like, I never knew anybody else does this. There's somebody working in the bank. Just one lady. We didn't even talk to all the other ones yet. Manager in the back, head office people. We even talk to them. Do they do that when they sign stuff? You know? But tell her. You know what I mean? Tell her knew what was up. Right? So, reserving your rights is essential in this, and I know somebody who's going to ask for it. Hold on one sec. I already hear you. I already hear you. Don't even say it. Right? So this is what you're gonna put. Right? That's what you're gonna put to reserve your rights. On anything that you sign or whatever with these so-called democracy colonizers. Right? And you just get a stamp made. And that way you stamp it, right, instead of writing, and then you just reserve your rights for registration, for cars, all that type of stuff. Reserve your rights, paying some credit card or whatever you were, everything that you were doing before, right? You learn about nationality and birthrights today, right? Everything that you're doing before, you're still doing going forward. All you're doing is reserving your rights from now forward. I don't care what it is. Anything that you sign with them, you reserve your rights on it. Any past stuff that you sign that's coming up, you reserve your rights on it this time with it coming up. Right? Because we're so far behind that we have to deal with these people. Right? That's just the reality of the situation. We're so far behind. We're 100 years behind this man that came in 1913. 100 years behind. right? Things that he had set up already, they tore down, right? Things that he had set up already back then, they tore down, so we would have nothing now and be in this situation. So being that we're under occupation, we're gonna have to deal with these people on some kind of level, right? Cool. If you're dealing with them, reserve your rights. That's your only escape. Because in a democracy, in occupied territory, in your home that's on land that's been escheated, contract makes the law, period. The nothing else is law in that jurisdiction. The only thing that makes the law is where you sign. That's it. That's the only place that makes the law, right? Where you sign is where the law is. And then anything that comes with that is coming with that because you signed, right? Right, so just come back with the same thing. Because remember that, and remember, we talked about this on Sunday with Brother Amari's situation, right? He showed a passport that doesn't have a free national name on it, right? But they're not questioning him about anything to do with that instrument. That's theirs. They're questioning him about free national jurisdiction stuff. They never brought up the name that's on the passport. So it's the same situation with if you have a license. It's irrelevant. They know that it's a fraud. If you know and you present yourself how you're supposed to present yourself, right? But if we don't know because we don't study, you know, it's like with the sister, you know, the queen mother at class, that, you know, studying again and whatever like that, yeah. Sorry, but that's all it is gonna be, studying, right? And it's up to you. Like, if you want to put in 12 hours, then put in 12 hours a day. Like, it's on you. If you want to do it like you're doing life or whatever, and only thing you got is books and you can't do anything else, then that's what you got to do, right? But the reality of the situation is we are under occupation by foreigners. And because we're under occupation and our people choose to be things that they're not, we have to accommodate the fraud, if you will, right? In certain circumstances, not across the board. Because, you know, certain things, nationality up, you know, whatever, right? But, you know, depending on what you're dealing with, pick your battles. If you have a pen knife and guy has, you know, the ball on the chain or whatever swinging, you might, you know, not want to get involved too deep, you know? The other question was how to reserve rights on applications or whatever like that. Same thing, right? Anytime you're dealing with these people, reserve your rights. Whatever it is, doesn't matter, because you know we have nothing right now, right? You know we have nothing. Everything that we have or had is under occupation, right? All the streets we had are under occupation, right? The buildings under occupation. So, you know, not be upset about, mad about. That's just what it is. We're born into this. So we'll just deal with it, right? Anything that requires, quote unquote, a signature, reserve your rights on it. Anything. Anything that requires a, quote unquote, initial, reserve your rights on it. Anybody that puts a screen in front of you and gives you a little stick thing and says, just put it here, reserve your rights on it, right? Because we're under occupation. And at this current time, being that we're under occupation, our position was to be what, you know, what Nobu Juwali said, we'll have our own government, our own body politic, and we don't have to deal with those people because we have our own manufacturing companies, we have our own press, we will have, so, you know, if we have press, eventually, you're going to have BET. That's just what it is. You start with the newspaper, and then from the newspaper, you're supposed to have ABC, NBC, or whatever, by a certain time after you start the newspaper. It's not just supposed to be a newspaper forever. It's media, right? And remember, he's a prophet, so he was setting stuff up for real, for the morning. When you want to, you know, why is it that it's like this is so hard? Why do we have to study 12 hours a day or whatever? Because, right, Negroes with fezzes on, and Negroes without fezzes, because I would say that they're Negroes because they chose to go there, right? They had a choice, and they chose to be Negroes, capitalized N's and all that. So that's their position, right? The other question was, about who was the pharaoh that dredged the Nile? Right. So we'll just go to Juwali. Because you see, when we went over here, Holy Quran, the Morris Holy Temple of Science, Morris Science Temple of America, right? Divinely prepared by Prophet Nobu Juwali, and you're going to go to chapter 47, right? It talks about the dredging, okay? Now, what we have to recognize as well is that when we say Nobu Juwali wrote something, right? When we say Nobu Juwali wrote something down, right? The reason why he wrote that down, is that this is what it's there for, right? The reason why Nobu Juwali wrote certain things down and put them in form for us to use as a reference is so that we can do research, right? Because everything that he put down is a key to something else, right? Which leads to something else and something else, and it continues to go that way, right? So this is what came up, right? This is what came up when I just Googled Pharaoh dredge Nile. Right, just those three words, Pharaoh, dredge Nile, and this is what came up, right? The Egyptians have had a very different relationship with the Nile. For thousands of years, they referred to its annual flooding as the gift of the Nile. Each summer, like clockwork, the river would take possession of a strip of land on either side of its banks. When the water receded, a very thin, even spread layer of black mud was left behind. Farmers would immediately plant their crops, never needing fertilizers because the flood soil was so rich. This narrow strip along the Nile, together with the delta at the river's northern mouth, is the only farmland Egypt has. Though it totals only 3% of the country's land, it has provided ample food for thousands of years. But recently, a population boom has forced Egyptians to increase their agricultural output. In 1970, they completed the Aswan High Dam, which stretches across the Nile 600 miles south of Cairo. The dam has effectively stopped the river's annual floods by trapping its waters in a reservoir that is slowly releasing during the dry season, blah, 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 right? Now, if they're talking about modern day farmers doing this, right? Right? Farmers doing this, then we have to recognize that when Nobu Juwali talks about the dredging of the Nile, right, and Pharaoh doing that, It's not something that a pharaoh did. There's not a first pharaoh that dredged the Nile. All the pharaoh that it's part of the culture, right? It's something that they've been doing since before pharaohs. They've been doing that, right? Because remember, Egypt is late. Kemet's late. We're talking, it's got Kush and all that that we didn't even talk about yet. And they got their own history, their own books up there, right? Moons being, moon being attached to mountaintops and stuff like that, right? So when we go further with stuff that Noble Drew Ali put down, right? This is where, like, you know, when people say, where do I start or whatever, you know, it's so much information. Start with what you don't know. Start there. And if you don't know anything, then there's you could just and start there, right? So if questions weren't answered or whatever, CanaanLandGuide@gmail.com, and we'll go further. And don't forget rvbaypublications.com. You got right to travel section in there. You got nationality card section in there. You got matriarch section in there, and lots more, right? You can MST online, right? MSTA online with Grand Chief Natural Bay. Information there. With regard to the questions, right? Also, Dr. Aleem El Bey, you'll get some information there as well, right? So, we had to deal with some Hebrew Israelites last week, and we just got some more info, so we just want to put that on there, you know, just to throw another, you know, bag on the donkey's back, right? But we're going to start with a quote by Brother Phil Valentine. L, by the way, right? Just so remember, don't forget. Don't think because, you know, there's no L in the hidden colors that he's not, you know. He's L. Don't even get it twisted, right? Negroes who are addicted to the dead letter or been indoctrinated by the dead letter have no personal, conscientious, spiritually inspired intelligence. This is Dr. Phil, right? The real Dr. Phil. Negroes who are addicted to the dead letter or Bible, scripture, or whatever, right? Or been indoctrinated by the dead letter have no personal, conscientious, spiritually inspired intelligence. The myth is your story. In fact, the myth is the story of the spirit. History is the story of the physical. Okay? So, the Negroes, who can't do anything but quote from King James, homo guy, right? They have no, but this is not what I'm saying. This is what Dr. Phil is saying. You have a problem, go talk to him, Negro, right? The Negroes who are addicted to that have no personal, conscientious, spiritually inspired intelligence. Okay? Now, Noble Drew Ali came and specifically told the Moors that you're not Negro, black, colored. Back then. And then we're still talking about Negroes and people calling themselves Negroes today. And black and colored as well, right? So for our brothers who like to claim that they're Hebrew, but they have nothing to do with Canaan because that's a curse stuff and all that, right? We'll just give you some more information just to, you know, put another bag on the donkey's back just to prove to you Hebrew Israelites that you're more. your Canaanites, Moabites, and all that that Nobujuali came and told all those guys, Ben Yahweh, Shadrach, all those dudes came and told all them that they're Moors. Mordecai, Herman, all of them came. And y'all coming now talking about, you know, one debate about you're not Canaanites and use Bible as a reference. Right? From this perspective, I don't think God directly told the Israelites to slaughter other people, such as the Canaanites, in an absolute or ontological sense. That is because I don't think that the Bible was written by God, nor is it word for God what God thinks or says. If the Bible is a human witness to God's revelation of himself in the world, then that witness is borne by men and women who lived in a certain history and certain culture. Therefore, the Bible must be seen in terms of the people who wrote it, as well as for what it tells us about the revelation of God in the world. Contrary to what we like to think, ancient Israelites were not modern Christians. They were not modern anything. They lived in 1200 BC and reflected the culture of that time. When they encountered God in the Exodus, they did not immediately become enlightened, so that they automatically understood everything about God that we understand nearly 3,500 years later. Their encounter with God was a significant one, but it was largely up to them to translate that revelation of God into practical living. And they struggled mightily over several hundred years to be able to do that adequately. So they spoke to God in terms of their own culture, just like they worshiped God in terms of their culture that they understood. They transformed that they understood. For example, sacrifices, circumcision, temples, prophet, etc. They transformed that culture based on their encounter with God, so they began moving to monotheism, social justice, authentic worship, etc. But it would take them nearly 1,000 years to get there. Yahweh has been experienced as a God of power, the God who fought Pharaoh, who parted the Red Sea, who led the Israelites through the desert, who parted the Jordan, who brought them into the land and toppled the walls of Jericho and routing the Canaanite and Philistine armies. This led to the idea that Yahweh, the God of the patriarchs, was a powerful warrior God, the God of the desert who could be counted on to march in with his heavenly armies in times of crisis. However, as the Israelites settled into the land, they encountered the fertility cult of Baal. They were easily convinced that while Yahweh may be God of the desert and God of battles and God of power, that Baal, who was in charge of the more mundane aspects of everyday life, such as rain and crops and livestock. The Israelites never abandoned the worship of Yahweh. They simply added the worship of Baal to their worship of Yahweh. When the Hebrew arrived at Canaan, the land promised to them millennia earlier, when God told Abraham at Shechem that the land will belong to his descendants, they began the long, painful, and disappointing process of settling the land. There were, after all, people already living there. These people, the Canaanites, speaking a language remarkably close to Hebrew. They were farmers, some were nomads, but they were also civilized. They had also learned military technology and tactics, as well as law. So the Hebrews, uncivilized, tribal, and nomadic, found themselves facing a formidable enemy. Even the accounts of this period in the Hebrew Bible, the books of Joshua and Judges, paint a pretty dreary picture of the occupation. After a few spectacular victories and some impressive territorial gains along the coastal plains, the Hebrews are eventually driven out of these areas and settle in the Central Hill Country, and a few places in the Jordan River Valley. While they held their own against the Canaanites, a new player had arrived on the scene. These people, the Philistines, had rushed down from the north and overwhelmed everyone in their path. They had chariots and iron weapons, etc., etc. So there's a bigger connection to these Hebrews and Canaanites than the Hebrews are willing to accept. And all you got to do is just accept the fact, right, that we're the same people And we're not the same people because we're Canaanites or Moabites or whatever, or Hebrew Israelites or Jews. We're the same people because we're more dark-skinned people that populated the earth. Okay? And when we talk about, yeah, let's bring it all together in unity and all that, the bringing it together in unity is us saying that we're more. Stop playing games and we're all this other stuff. Right? And everybody coming together with their other name talking about this is unity. The world's laughing. You see anybody else playing stupid stuff like that when it's unity time? When they have Greek Day and Turkey Day and Filipino Day, Sri Lankan Day, Tamil Day. You see them playing around about people throwing up different flags and all that? Right? El, Hebrew, El, God, the primitive generic word for God in the Semitic language, Aramaic, Elah, Arabic, Elah, Akkadian, Elu. In the Old Testament, El is used over 200 times for God. The name of the chief god of the Canaanites was El. The Hebrews borrowed this word from the Canaanites. Right? The Hebrews borrowed this word from the Canaanites. El is Canaanite word. Hebrews borrowed El from the Canaanites. Okay. But so you could take Canaanite stuff and use it, but they're the devilish people, and you're not gonna claim that you and them are true, but you could take their stuff and use it. It is a tribute to the high quality of the character of the God of Israel that when Hebrews took over this name and applied it to him, it lost all its evil connotation. Ham, the youngest son of Noah, born probably about 96 years before the flood and one of the 8 persons to live through the flood. He became the progenitor of the dark races, not the Negroes, but the Egyptians, Ethiopians, Libyans, and Canaanites. So Ham, the youngest son of Noah, and keep in mind, right, this is, Zondervan, Zondervan, Pictorial Bible Dictionary, right, and this is Ham on page 330, okay? So they talk about him being the youngest son of Noah. They talk about one of the 8 persons who lived through the flood, dark-skinned races. Now he's the progenitor. Ham is the progenitor of dark-skinned races, but not the Negroes. Right? Why Noble Drew Ali tell you that you're not Negro? Because by being Negro, you take yourself out of the human family. Because remember, that's just a spell cast out there. If you latch onto it and adopt it as reality, then there's your reality. Negro life. Right? Now, just to close out the Hebrew stuff, just so that, you know, people can shut the hell up and get down with the program. Right? And stop playing around. Right, we're all Moors. It's not a secret. Moor in German, Moor in French, Moor in Greek, Moor in every goddamn language. Right. So, brother Amar Ameth Bey saw the class, right, and sent this testimonial email, Canaanland Guide@gmail.com. Right. So people know that the email's out there to use to send stuff. Because you know we're going to put it out there, right? So that people could see how real it is, not just Cujo talking or whatever, that this is real, right? The Hebrews have no clout outside and inside America. I made an exodus to escape the wrath that was coming to Babylon. I found in my journeys that your status is still a nigger even with an American passport. I got deported from Egypt twice. The last two times, I didn't even get out of the airport. I was under the supervision of armed guards. And the reason, because I had Christian literature, Bible, Apocrypha, Bible dictionary, Strong Concordance, and along with a fictional name claiming to be someone else, the straw man. One of the soldiers questioned me. He asked me, "Where is your grandfather and father from?" I said, "America." He looked puzzled as if he knew something I didn't. There was another who had been detained in flea-infested cells, but not me. The Israelites have no power and is not recognized. I remember when we extend our visas, they keep them for about 3 days. When I came back home the first time to get some more money to sustain myself over, I got jammed up at the airport in customs. I missed my flight. Finally, I got home. But on top of that, before I got to Egypt, I was in Ghana. When I left the airport in New York, they placed a red sticker like a dot on my passport. I later took it off. Didn't know what it meant. There were all kinds of surveillance on us in Egypt. Every time we went outside to exercise or go to the store, there was someone watching us taking pictures. We even tried to teach a brother who was a Muslim. I think it was him who put the heat on us. Plus, it was other people over there from the States that were bugging out. Later, we were informed by an Egyptian friend that we were being watched. So after I got deported, I flew to England. We had some people there. From there, I was in Cyprus. Things didn't work out, so I came back home and got jammed up again at customs. Nationality is key. Status is important. Just claiming to be something without proper backing is foolish and unwise. The Israelites are seen as a radical Christian with no clear understanding, hypocritical, just like a Christian. When I was leaving a second time, they jammed me up in New York. Put me in a glass box. TSA member looked like he was ready to kick my ass and everything. One man said, "I didn't know what you did, but they got you labeled as a terrorist." There was an air marshal on the plane, and everything of this has been an experience. I don't think I might fly internationally or domestic, as I was informed the reason I was getting jammed up was for overstaying a visa, but that's all on me. But what a price to pay for trying to play God's chosen people without proper paperwork. Peace and Islam, right? So, and that brother's ex-Hebrew Israelite, down with that, hard down with that. And it took him going through that to realize that that's a fraud, right? So don't get yourself caught up. Use that as an example, because only a Moor would come out and tell you. A Hebrew Israelite wouldn't come out and tell you, "Oh, they got jammed up and arrested and all that stuff," because they have to make their stuff look good, because it's a fraud. So they have to do whatever they can to make that look like something, right? Dress it up, you know. You have people putting out stuff, they look like Ninja Turtles and stuff like that, right? So, remember, right, that it's not about being Negro. Now, we talked about, people, right, that consider themselves Negro, but were speaking highly against that position, right? Now, this is a picture of Nanny Helen Burroughs, born May 2nd, 1878. And she had this writing called "What the Negro Must Do," right? "What the Negro Must Do." So this is Nanny Helen Burroughs, B-U-R-R-O-U-G-H-S. You need a researcher, right? One, the Negro must learn to put first things first. The first things are education, development of character traits, a trade, and home ownership. Right? Education, study, study, study. You know, we've already told Morris to be educated, to go get an education, right? So he could use you or whatever. Okay? Development of character traits, right? Circle 7 Quran. You go through all the chapters, right? There's chapters in there dealing with young men and women, or husband and wife, magistrate, subject. Everybody has some rules or orders that they should be following if they're claiming to be, quote unquote, a citizen of whatever, right? You have to have some type of character, or like what we read, what Noble Dwali said before, it's free national standards. National standards and character are relative, right? A trade, okay, so you already know, a trade. Why? Because you having a trade means that you're able to assist your nation. But remember, when this was during the industrial age, when it was about having a trade. Now it's about having a trade because everything else is technically, you know, it will get you caught up in the mix-up, right? But a trade is something that you die with. You know, you can't die with no collection, telemarketing degree or whatever. Trade is something that becomes part of you, right? And home ownership, right? Going back again to recognizing the priorities, right? Recognizing the priorities. Stack water, not gold and silver. Yeah, you could have some. I'm not saying don't have any. I'm not saying just get water and no gold and silver. Cujo said don't. No. Right? Pick your battle. Use your intelligence. Dwali said if I can get you to think, you'll save yourself. Right? Two, the Negro must stop expecting God and white folk to do for him what he can do for himself. Comes back to the same thing with the unity. Right? We have unity. We have unification. That was the purpose of all the temples. Why is it a temple? Because it's a society. It's a family. Right? All those people in the temple support each other. All those people in the temple have a trade they do for each other. They're not going out there doing for somebody else. Right? No. And remember, she's speaking from an intelligent Negro perspective. Right? She's not speaking from slave perspective, ain't and whatever like that, right? She's actually using words like ownership, right? Expecting, right? Expecting. She knows something, right? The Negro must keep free. The Negro must keep himself, his children, and his home clean and make the surroundings in which he lives comfortable and attractive. Okay? So it doesn't say anything about whether, you know, it's your place or you're renting or whatever. Right? You have a duty. It's like the neighbor. My neighbor right here is probably like 70s or whatever. And a few times me and him are in the hall, right, wiping down the walls or whatever, because there's stuff on the wall, been on the wall, and you know, why are we going to call when we could just wipe the wall? You know what I mean? And then we're there, he's European, you know what I mean? And we'll have some good conversations, some good history conversations and stuff like that, you know what I mean? Right? Because, you know, his perspective is, I live here. You know what I mean? I don't care. I'm 80 or whatever. But this is my door right here. That's my wall right there. Yeah, I'm renting, but I see that wall. Super doesn't see that wall. I see that wall every day. And if something's on it, I'm going to come clean it. I get it. Right? So keeping your surroundings comfortable and attractive and clean, right? The Negro must learn to dress more appropriately for work and for leisure. This is probably more than ever. We need this one right now. Okay? The Negro must learn to dress more appropriately for work and for leisure. Okay? 5. The Negro must make his religion an everyday practice and not just a Sunday go-to-meeting emotional affair. This is back then. Right? What did Drew Ali tell them about that? The Negro must make his religion an everyday practice and not just a Sunday go-to-meeting emotional affair. So as soon as you start talking about making your religion something more than a Sunday emotional affair, right? You're indirectly saying that you're giving Christianity back to the Europeans. And you're going back to your ancient practices, whatever they are. But it ain't going to be no homo book, right? That's not where we're going to go. We'll find any other book, but not that one. Any book but that one, right? 6. The Negro must highly resolve to wipe out mass ignorance. Highly resolve to wipe out mass ignorance. Right? So this is back then. She's talking about mass ignorance back then. So what we got now? If they had mass ignorance back then, the ignorance that we have now can't be called mass ignorance. Right? Because it's beyond mass ignorance right now. 7. The Negro must stop charging his failures up to his color and to white people's attitudes. Same thing like Morris said. Stop blaming the European. Take some responsibility, right? She's talking like a Moor to Negroes. And then they didn't even listen to her. They didn't even listen to her. Negro amongst them, right? Negro amongst them telling them what they got to do to better themselves. And all these things so far, right and exact, she hasn't missed nothing yet. Right? She hasn't missed a thing yet. She's right on point. 8. The Negro must overcome his bad job habits. Right? Everybody knows, you know, few. Right? If you have a job, you know few that number 8 apply to. Right? And what is it that we got to do? Uplift all humanity. Because people have fallen to such a level that there was people that had bad job habits back then that she had to make it a point in her message to the Negroes. She had to make it a point. Why? Because I'm going to teach the European, right? I'm going to leave the European here long enough to teach you government. Right? That's prophecy of the prophet through a Negro. Right? Because the majority of us will be working for him at this point back then. Right? So you get your job habits correct. So when you get your own, when you become an owner of a corporation, company, whatever, right? You would know what the standard is for the people below you. Instead of, you know, having the Negro messed up running the stuff and then stuff falling around and then we're blaming crabs in the bucket and oh yeah, no, crabs in the bucket, crab pulled me down in the bucket again and whatever like that when it ain't that, right? It's far from that because ain't nobody was in a bucket and we're not crabs around here, so let's get real, right? He must improve his conduct in public places, right? Once again, okay, because you already know, I know, I can vouch, right, for schools or corners having no standing, no loitering signs there, because, you know, back in the day, we, you know, we didn't do good stuff in public places. Did stuff, throw stuff, break stuff, whatever, right? The Negro must learn how to operate business for people, not for Negro people only. Right? What's you know, prophecy again, right? Mobutu Ali told the Moors that one day all wheels of industry are gonna stop. But then when it starts up again, it's gonna be in the Asiatics' favor. Because Negroes were supposed to learn how to operate business, because Mobutu Ali had business, and he said, you know, imitate I the prophet. So if he had a manufacturing company, then every Moor was supposed to have a manufacturing company on top of whatever other company that you want to have, right? Because as Moors, we have stocks in this. We have stocks in this, right? And we have to step up to the plate. You know what I mean? Deal with each other, support each other. You know what I mean? Right? And let others know about us so they can support us. Because I don't think I've ever seen out here Chinese shop anywhere other than the Chinese supermarket. Like, nowhere. Only place that they go to the supermarket is the Chinese supermarket. Well, nobody's not calling them racist though, and, you know, glorifying their self and all that. That's just standard. Support your own. You know, you have more Europeans going to the Chinese supermarket than they're going to the European supermarket. Why? Because, you know, business is not for that one individual only. Businesses for everybody, because everybody has something that somebody wants, you know what I mean, and whatever price they could get it, if they could afford it, they'll buy it. That's more so why we should support each other, especially in the conscious community, because half stuff in the conscious community, people don't even charge you what it's really worth to get it, right? People don't even charge you what it's really worth. Half the time you get stuff for free almost, and people still wouldn't go in their pocket and give something, even though they got it for free. Just because, just out of, you know what I mean, quote unquote, unity. Put it in the pocket and just give something up, right? But, you know, and learn to operate business doesn't mean, you know, you have to go to university, take a business management course or whatever. You know, just go to Khalifa Media or something. I'm sure they got something up there about starting something with regard to business, right? Pretty sure something's up there, right? 11, the average so-called educated Negro will have to come down out of the air. He is too inflated over nothing. So back then they had Boulay. Before Boulay, they had Boulay, right? And sisters recognizing that there's so-called Negroes that are educated, right? So-called Negroes that are educated, that, you know, are playing the high horse, right? They're better than somebody because they're educated, right? That's how some more is going with this knowledge. Like, this isn't for everybody, right? This is everybody's stuff. This is not just Moore's information. Mobutu Ali is not just Moore's prophet. Yeah, he's our prophet. Don't talk about him too loud around that guy, because that guy's not a mark. Nah. Right? He's everybody's prophet. You know? Especially nowadays, when there are false prophets out here, all these false prophets out here, and there's not one legit prophet around right now. You know what I mean? Right? 12. The Negro must stop forgetting his friends. The Negro must stop forgetting his friends. And then that ties right back in with 11, because majority of the time it's those Boule Negroes that jump ship, right? And then try to make it seem like they're down now later, when they weren't down with nothing. Sellouts. Right. I just want to put this one up too. Abyssinian pilgrims at Jerusalem. Abyssinian pilgrims at Jerusalem. Abyssinian pilgrims at Jerusalem. Now, if these are Abyssinian pilgrims, right? Right? In Jerusalem. Okay? Now, you know, I already know. You know, Holy Land, blah, 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 right? Whatever, right? Falashas, Orthodox, Christian, which is really a Jew because everything's relative and everybody's wearing fezes because they really know that the fez is a science headwear, right? It's a degree of knowledge headwear. So it applies to anybody who has a certain degree of knowledge that somebody else might not have, that they don't know about. Abyssinian, right? That's why Noble Drawley said that you're not Ethiopian, because really you're Abyssinian, and Abyssinians used to wear fezes. Yeah, for real. Yeah. But the Rastas will never tell you that, because they want to be Ethiopian, right? They want to be Ethiopian. They don't want to be Abyssinian, because Abyssinian is relative to the Moors. Abyssinian is relative to the Moors. So make sure you tell all your Rasta friends, right, that you saw the picture with the Abyssinians, right? Don't forget, look at the costume, look at how they're dressed, right? They're dressed just like Bobo priests and all those guys, right? Naya Bingi, 12 tribes, right? Make sure your hair is covered and all that, right? Turbans, remember, right? Okay? Let them know so they could come back home. Stop playing around. They don't need to play around. Right? Make sure you go back and check the Sabir Bey show from today. Right? I think the third song that they played, the KRS Mad Lion song, when they're telling you about your history, asking you about, you know, do you even know who your prophet is and all that stuff. And everything just going past people. Right? When it's very obvious. Right? And we're just keeping it up there because hopefully, you know, it'll stick in your brain. Next time you see a Rasta that looks just like one of these guys right here, with the beard and all that, right? That you let them know, right? That they're Moors and they better come home. Okay? It's that real right now. Really real. The Abyssinian Moors. Because why? Because we're not Ethiopian. We'll never be Ethiopian. Right? Never, ever will we be Ethiopian. Why? Because Prophet Drawley told the Moors that we're not that. If you want to be that, cool. You're on your own. Right? Servants were usually invisible, with one exception, the Abyssinian guards. They were not soldiers. They had no other function except to open and close doors and to signal by a sudden noiseless entrance into the room that one of their imperial majesties was about to appear. The guards formed a part of the court since Peter the Great. The Russian consul to Ethiopia recruited the guards, or they were given as human gifts by the Ethiopian emperor. Right? Remember, you know, black on black. Stuff. Then somebody had somebody as slaves, but then never talk about, you know, us having our own people as slaves, and we never talk about it, right? But even the Ethiopians did it, right? Even the Ethiopians, remember, the Ethiopian emperor, okay? Because there is when that's how you know the fraud. Just like when, you know, you hear people sliding, you know. Yeah, Barack Obama, the American president, and stuff like that, when there's no such thing as American president, right? Same thing, you slide in the Ethiopian emperor, right? Denationalize the emperor right there, when really Abyssinia, right? The only requirement was that they be Christian and that they stand immensely tall, okay? Now we're talking about Ethiopian Orthodox Christian, not, you know, pale Jesus or whatever, okay? Even though he's recognized, but it's not, that's not the real deal. But not all of these men were from Ethiopia. Two of them were American. One man was Sam and came from the Riggs Plantation in Georgia. Little is known of Sam or how he got to Russia. The more well-known guard was Jim Hercules. Born to former slaves somewhere in South 1867, taking advantage of freedom, Jim moved to New York and became something of a famous boxer. After touring Europe fighting in the ring, he settled in London and took British citizenship. There he was seen by Empress Marie Feodorovna, Feodorovna, and invited to Russia, where Alexander III offered him a job as an Abyssinian guard. He stayed on under Nicholas II. It is said that every couple of years, Jim would return to America to visit his family and return to Russia with gifts of homemade guava jellies for the imperial children, right? Only one people out there talk about guava jelly, just so you know, right? Only one people talk about guava jelly and guava jam, right? The guard stood out from the rest of the servants, not only for being quote-unquote black and imposingly tall, but also for their unique attire. They wore coats of black wool embroidered with double-headed eagles in gold thread over short white jackets, waistcoats of crimson velvet with wide woolen trousers. A red turban or velvet fez with a gold tassel completed the ensemble. Prince Christopher of Greece wrote, "Tall, splendid, built in their wide trousers and scarlet turbans, they stood immobile as though they had been cast in bronze." No one knows what happened to Jim and Sam after the revolution. They no longer had jobs after abdication. It had been reported that Jim stayed with the Tsar right up until his abdication. Of course, you know they had to have a picture of Jim Hercules, the Moor, the Abyssinian guard of the Russian court, right? Of the Russian court. Not of the Moorish court, of the Russian court. And they had enough intelligence to make the ensemble, the quote-unquote ensemble, right? Be a turban or a fez. I think somebody knows something. Somebody knows something and not telling. Not telling the Negroes. Right? Not telling the Negroes. Right? Marcus Garvey, 1922. "We are looking toward political freedom on the continent of Africa, the land of our fathers. The difference between the Universal Negro Improvement Association and the other movements of this country and probably the world is that the Universal Negro Improvement Association seeks independence of government." Key point. First point. Independence of government. This is Marcus Garvey talking for all the people who, you know, say that there's no relation between Marcus Garvey and Noble Drew Ali, right? Independence of government means self-government, right? "While the other organizations seek to make the Negro a secondary part of existing governments," right? Everybody else claiming that they're everything in the book, but when you ask them for ID, they're going to show you some corporate democracy identification. But they're conscious, and they know their self, and they use plantain soap and shea butter, you know, organic toothpaste, you know, no eggs and stuff like that. But if you ask them for ID, they'll show you colonizer stuff. Right? We differ from the organizations in America because they seek to subordinate the Negro as a secondary consideration in a great civilization, knowing that in America the Negro will never reach his highest ambition, knowing that the Negro in America will never get his constitutional rights. Point two, not civil rights, not rights because, you know, we need the reparations because the slave master, white man, did or whatever. Constitutional rights. This is 1922, right? This is 1922. And remember, all these guys like to talk about Marcus Garvey's saying from 1917, right, that he never heard about Noble Drew Ali. Well, by 1922, I think he heard about him because he's talking about constitutional rights in his speech, right? Okay? He was inspired. And again, comes back to the same thing of why would Noble Drew Ali tell the Moors, you're not Negro black colored, right? But then make a Negro the forerunner of his movement. Why would he make a Negro the forerunner of his movement? A Negro. He's going to make the Negro a forerunner of his movement. And you're going to listen to these guys debating, right? Sliding, you know, Noble Drew Ali in there, get their little shots in at him. You know what I mean? Bringing up Garvey. Talking about he never met Noble Drew Ali before or whatever. When Noble Drew Ali, remember, Noble Drew Ali said, think and save yourself, right? Think and save yourself. So think how much dumb people out there, right, are going to, yeah. Marcus Garvey said that he never met Noble Drew Ali. Okay. So let's say he did say that, right? Noble Drew Ali did too many great things to be so asinine, right, to make a Negro the forerunner of his movement that says you're not Negro. Prophet's not stupid like that, right? And people who are dumbfounded, right, and take the position that they never met and they had no relations, and you know what I mean, there's this one book written by this one guy with this one quote that says Noble Drew Ali never met Marcus, or Marcus Garvey never knew nothing about Noble Drew Ali, right? But Garveyites will rep, you know, Haile Selassie, you know, and Rastafarians will rep Marcus Garvey, but Haile Selassie said he doesn't respect the Negro. And he was referring to Marcus Garvey when he said that. Right? So obviously, Marcus Garvey got enough to know that he has to change his tune. And just like Noble Drew Ali coming out and saying, you know, Allah is feminine in 1913 is the same thing as Marcus Garvey changing the Negro Improvement Association to something other than Negro and trying to get all these people who joined it because their perspective is I'm a Negro, so I guess I could join this, you know, and they're doing stuff for the Negroes or whatever, that he's going to go change their perspective when they're already in it. They'll leave just like what they did to Noble Drew Ali. Right? So he kept it what it was because it is what it is. But guaranteed, when he got out of that prison in Atlanta because of Noble Drew Ali, who went to visit him, one day before he got deported, right? He was going to tell all those Garveyites that they go better do proclaim their nationality. And remember, he had the other half, because we're not talking about you, NY yet. Well, NY wasn't around yet. So it was NAACP, Noble Drew Ali, and Marcus Garvey. And everybody was down with Marcus Garvey and Noble Drew Ali at that time. Right? So remember, constitutional rights. This is Garvey talking. All these organizations which are fostering the improvement of Negroes in the British Empire know that the Negro in the British Empire will never reach the height of his constitutional rights. What do I mean by constitutional rights in America? If the black man is to reach the height of his ambition in this country, if the black man is to get all of his constitutional rights in America, then the black man should have the same chance in the nation as any other man to become president of the nation or a street cleaner in New York. If the black man in the British Empire is to have all his constitutional rights, it means that the Negro in the British Empire should have at least the same right to become Premier of Great Britain as he has become a street cleaner in the city of London. Are they prepared to give us such political equality? Right. So he's posing the question of, are they prepared to give us that political equality? Right? He already knows they're not. That's why in the beginning he told you that he's about independence of government. We don't need to get nothing from them. What we need from them, if we have our own stuff, which is where he was leading, which is where Noble Drew Ali came to do. Right? So he's setting everybody up for Noble Drew Ali. Like, recognize that he's the setup man. When you say the forerunner, he's the guy setting everybody up to get the bat to the head. He's bringing them around the corner, one by one, just nice and slow. Bringing them around the corner. And Drew Ali just waiting, smack him with it. Everybody, and everybody's game, following him around the corner. And then cut him off. And then had everybody just stop following. Because, you know, they weren't studying. They were being led. Right? That's where we come in. But we're studious now. We're different. You know, we're taking the steps ourselves. We don't need somebody come take the steps for us. Right? That was done already. You know what I mean? We recognize what Noble Drew Ali did. And we recognize the connection that Noble Drew Ali had and why he made Marcus Garvey the forerunner of the Moorish movement. Because Marcus Garvey was the only other real person speaking from a nationhood perspective that the people could grasp nationhood. You and I can live in the United States of America for 100 more years, and our generations may live for 200 or for 5,000 more years. And so long as there is a black and white population, when the majority is on the side of the white race, you and I will never get political justice or get political equality in this country. Then why should a black man with rising ambition, after preparing himself in every possible way to give expression to the highest ambition, allow himself to be kept down by racial prejudice within a country? If I am as educated as the next man, if I am as prepared as the next man, if I have passed through the best schools and colleges and universities as the other fellow, why should I not have a fair chance to compete with the other fellow for the biggest position in the nation? I have feelings, I have blood, I have senses like the other fellow. I have ambition, I have hope. Why should he, because of some racial prejudice, keep me down? And why should I concede to him the right to rise above me and to establish himself as my permanent master? This is where the UNI differs from other organizations. I refuse to stultify my ambition. And every true Negro refuses to stultify his ambition to suit anyone. And therefore, the UNIA decides if America is not big enough for two presidents, if England is not big enough for two kings, then we are not going to quarrel over the matter. We will leave one president in America. We will leave one king in England. We will leave one president in France. And we will have one president in Africa. Hence, the Universal Negro Improvement Association does not seek to interfere with the social and political systems of France, but by the arrangement of things today, the UNIA refuses to recognize any political or social system in Africa except that which we are about to establish for ourselves. We are not preaching a propaganda of hate against anybody. We love the white man. We love all humanity. I don't know how come the Garveyites and them, they don't quote this part from Marcus Garvey, right? They don't quote this part. We love the white man. We love all humanity, right? Noble Drawley came and said humanity, right? Okay. Because we feel that we cannot live without the other. The white man is as necessary to the existence of the Negro as the Negro is as necessary to his existence. There is a common relationship that we cannot escape. Africa has certain things that Europe wants, and Europe has certain things that Africa wants. And if a fair and square deal must bring white and black with each other, it is impossible for us to escape it. Africa has oil, diamonds, copper, gold, and rubber, and all the minerals that Europe wants. And there must be some kind of relationship between Africa and Europe for a fair exchange. So we cannot afford to hate anybody. And that's Marcus Garvey, 1922. Telling them what they have to do. Right? Letting them know what they have to do. Are they considering or taking what is said serious? No. Right? Again, Negroes speaking from the perspective of Moors, so that there's no dispute about the direction that Noble Drawley was going, because all these Negroes were out there going in the same direction, but just under the banner of Negro, right? And all those people are forerunners, because the idea is to get the people's mindset for the coming prophet. Think about it, Sister Burroughs. Think about the stuff that she was talking about, right? And if people adopted that perspective, think about what we just read with Marcus Garvey, what he was talking about. And let's say all the people adopted what they were saying, like, yeah, constitutional rights or whatever. What do you think would have happened when Noble Drawley came? You think people would have, you know, blindsided what he brought? They would have took that face to face, because they would have been prepared to just make a smooth transition from black, Negro, colored, whatever, right into more stuff, because it's dealing with constitutional rights, constitutions, and they're used to that coming out of slavery, because all their black, Negro, colored leaders were talking the same way. The exact same way as how Noble Drawley was talking. They were just doing it as Negro. Right? The League of Struggle for Negro Rights. Right? So, the Negroes came together and they made a league. And the league was for the struggle for Negro rights. Not a league for Negro rights. A league of the struggle. They made a league for the struggle that it is to try to get accepted as a Negro and not get accepted. Think about that. These educated Negroes, right? These educated Negroes made a league, right? When you think league, think of League of Nations, right? All the different black, Negro, colored, whatever organization heads from wherever coming together, and everybody saying, okay, well, you guys gonna be the chairman, then these guys are going to be the whatever, and these guys are going to be the secretaries, and these guys are going to be the whatever, and then they have a league. And this league is for the struggle for Negro rights. Okay? The league was organized by the Communist Party in 1930 as the successor to the American Negro Labor Congress. The League was particularly active in organizing support for Scottsboro Boys, Scottsboro Boys. Nine black men sentenced to death in 1931 for crimes they did not commit. It also campaigned for a separate black nation in the South. Early 1930s, black nation in the South in the early 1930s and against police brutality, the Italian occupation of Ethiopia and Jim Crow laws, while also advocating a more general policy for opposition of fascism and support for the Soviet Union. Langston Hughes became its president in 1934. Harry Haywood was its general secretary. The organization largely disappeared after 1935 when the Communist Party, as part of its Popular Front stage strategy, joined with non-communist organizations and individuals to form the National Negro Congress. So the Bill of Civil Rights for Negro People. Right? So remember, this is in retaliation, if you will, right? Against the Scottsboro boys and how they were, you know, quote unquote, denied their position, right? But this is the title of the bill now, right? Bill of Civil Rights for the Negro People, against discrimination by reason of nationality or color or of so-called race. This is 1930, okay? Proposed by the League of Struggle for Negro Rights, endorsed by the National Scottsboro Action Committee. Whereas the 13 million Negro people of the United States, and especially those who reside in the Black Belt of the South, where they constitute a majority of the population, are denied the rights of citizenship and equality, and are deprived of their right to vote, to serve on all juries, and to enjoy equal rights in courts of law, and are held on the land in peonage and debt slavery. This is Negroes talking, huh? And because of their lack of political rights, are habitually framed up and are enslaved in penal servitude for trivial offenses. Remember, this is 1930, okay? And this is exactly what we're going through right now, right? Let's go back again, because the Negroes are going in on the Negroes, right? Okay. The majority of the population are denied rights of citizenship and equality. Same thing they're arguing today. They are deprived their right to vote. Same thing they're arguing today. To serve on all juries and to enjoy equal rights of the courts. Same thing they're arguing today, right? Are held on the land in peonage and debt slavery. Same thing that they're talking about today. And because of their lack of political rights and habitually, like chain smoking, right? Are habitually framed up. How much people you know, somebody put a gun on them, somebody put crack in their pocket, somebody put meth on them. Somebody said, yo, go meet that guy. He wants to buy a pound or whatever. And then you never see that person ever again. Right? Framed up. Okay? And are enslaved in penal servitude. How much people you know that's inside in the big house right now? And they never did anything. But they're just in there. Just because. We know lots. We named them all off on Blog Talk every Tuesday. Right, and there's way more than that. So if you know some, send them the names so we can put their names out there. Right? For trivial offenses. So not just that they're enslaved in penal servitude, but it's for trivial offenses. This is in 1930. And people are gonna talk about like when Morris say, you know, oh yeah, you know, using the black codes on you guys or whatever. If you call yourself black, nah, you guys ain't doing whatever. That's not ever, they're not doing that, that's over, slavery's over and all that. And they're talking about the exact same things that we're dealing with right now today, right? The exact same problems they're talking about right now. They're talking about right now, right? Or no offense at all in the chain gang system, and are otherwise subjected to intolerable discrimination and oppression. Therefore, The following law is proposed. Right? One. So this is what they're putting forward, right? Same way that UN comes together, put forward something, right, for the international community, and the OAS come together, put together, and they put out something for the you know, American states. Okay, these Negroes came together with the help of some Europeans, of course, and put together something for the Negroes. That the Negroes were supposed to say, okay, yeah, we endorse that, and then get down with that. But they didn't want to do that. Right? That's why the organization largely disappeared after 1935. Because at 1930, Noble Jewell is already off the scene. So all these things that they're doing are just hope to catch some people. Because everybody had a constitutional mindset. And they were supposed to get down with the prophet. Right? And when you piece it together by looking at all the history of the history of us being called Negro, Black, Colored, and how those things were set up, right? And how, you know, there's this gap of history, right? Before 1930, that you don't hear about in the conscious community, right? They'll go before that, but that 1900 to 1930 gap, that, you know, whenever they talk about that time, all they talk about is NAACP and all that type of stuff, and, you know, things relative to, you know, Blacks, Negroes, trying to get some whatever, and they don't talk about the prophet at all. We already know, because we came out of that. Like, we know what we learned, and we never heard about Noble Jewell ever until right now. Seeing the guy with a fez on with an afro, like, what is this? What's this guy on? Right? In all states, territories, or possessions of the United States and the District of Columbia, right? So they're being very specific as to what they're talking about, right? No person shall be deprived of the right to vote or intimidated in an election or primary election or referendum by reason of color, nationality, race, or ancestry for non-payment of any tax, nor on grounds of education or proper disqualification, right? So they have nationality in there. Right? That's Article 1. Okay? Article 2. No person shall be deprived of the right to serve on grand juries or petit juries, or excluded from jury lists or panels of any of the above reasons, nor by any device directly or indirectly to accomplish the same purpose. Okay? Grand juries and petit juries. Right? So you're going to look up grand jury to see what that is, and then you're going to look up petit jury, see what that is, and then you realize what jurisdiction this Negro is talking about with regard to being on the jury. Like, you know, like they want to get the calls to be on jury duty. How come they want to get the calls to be on jury duty? Because jury duty back then and jury days there is two different jury duties. Right? Jury duty is a constitutional position where you take oath. Right? No person shall be excluded. No person shall be excluded from any school or class maintained by either public or private funds because of color, race, or nationality. Nationality again, nor by any device to accomplish the same purpose, nor shall there be any segregation or distinction made among students or among teachers of different colors, race, or nationality again, nor any difference or segregation in accommodations. So all the stuff that Negroes are crying for right now, oh, they cut my daughter's hair in the school because she answered a question. Oh, they slapped her. Oh, they did this, they did that. Well, the League for the Struggle of Negro Rights in 1930 came and brought you guys that no person shall be excluded from any school, but you didn't endorse it. What are you complaining about? They're not to complain about. You didn't endorse it, so take the abuse. Take the haircuts, whatever else that you get in those schools that aren't for our children. That we don't recognize that those schools aren't for our children. We just keep sending them there. Oh, it's okay, you know, whatever. You get the education or whatever like that, right? And remember, nothing's wrong with them going there if they're getting some type of outside deprogram. If they're getting some outside deprogram, they go to school from 8 to 3. They come home, they deprogram. The next day they go to school, and then they come home and they deprogram. Then at the end of the year, after all the deprogram program, you know, they get a final exam from the deprogram program, and then they ace that, and then they ace their school. And that means you could have just homeschooled. That means that they could learn outside of that institution. But that's only gonna happen if the parents decide to homeschool. Use all these morons that are homeschooling as an example. Right? There's lots of morons that are homeschooling. Right? Because of that mentality. Oh no, I'm more. Why am I gonna go to the European school? Yeah. You know, I get with it. If you're going to go do the work, then sure, homeschool. You know? Or if you got the fiat, you know, or whatever medium or exchange you're going to use, yeah, hire somebody to be that teacher. You know? But, you know, again, it comes back to Noble Drew Ali, that if, you know, he said do that from 1913 or whatever, you know, and it's 2014, and we're talking about, you know, the same problem, the Negro problem. That's only going to be solved if the Negro realizes that, not that. The black guy realizes not, okay, I get this. You know, I can't be that. You know, not only that you can't be that, but that, oh yeah, just to go back to the homeschool, Sister Zara put a good one out there. If you could potty train your children, you could homeschool them. If you can get your child to say, hey, mom, dad, I didn't pee-pee in my diaper or whatever. I didn't pee-pee in my pull-up. I used the toilet. Then you're a good parent and you could actually homeschool. All you need is a curriculum. And Moore's got that, because, you know, like I said, there's been Moores, and there are Moores, and there's going to be Moores that they're not sending their children into them brainwash camps when they could use egg cartons and teach etymology, right? So let's not get too carried away, you know, with pulling them all out, and then you're sitting there panicking because, you know, you don't have no babysitter, you gotta go to work, you miss 8 days trying to teach and all that stuff. Like, don't stress yourself. You know, if they gotta go in there, you could send them in there. But, you know, that's why we're supposed to have temples and all that, so that you can do the deprogram. When they go up in there, you got a Saturday or a Friday or what, you know, whatever, however the temple runs, and, you know, we deprogram by putting in the right info. Right? But that's what everybody's doing. Chinaman's doing it, Turk's doing it, Jew's doing it, everybody's doing it. If children goes to the crazy people school, after school, they come home and, you know, they gotta do their hours of, you know, our stuff. Right? So a few more of these things, because these Negroes have to understand that educated Negroes who they respect and, you know what I mean, uphold and all that stuff, you know what I mean, that had them marching, picketing and all that for stuff, they actually had literature. And now that we can read, since, you know, we're not slaves no more and all that stuff, and, you know, we got dashikis now and we speak Arabic and, you know, we know Kabbalah and Hebrew and all this stuff. All right, cool. Let's start reading some stuff now, right? And recognize that we've been told for a very long time, even Negroes told us how to solve the Negro problem. Even Negroes that were educated told the Negroes how to solve the Negro problem. So we have to recognize that it's us. We have to recognize that we have to take the responsibility to make sure that if we have this info, that we're putting it out there for others to know. Talking to them, putting out something in writing, making a video about whatever experience you had as a Moor, just because people need to know how real it is. You know what I mean? The same way that the sovereign guy could put up some fake ass right to travel thing with his boy wearing a police uniform, you know, to get people excited. You know what I mean? We can show real, actual documented proof, because remember, you know, a free national name gives you judicial standing, right? So you can say something, right? You can put something up. Don't worry about nobody coming at you because you said something. Nobody coming after no more. You see somebody go after Tajay, how come they never try to assassinate Tajay? Right? They can't, nobody not touching no more. Right? They ain't touching no more. Especially Moors who study and know what's what. Why? Like I told you, right? They kidnapped the brother at the border. They brought him back here. They waited for some other officers to come, then bring him back. You don't take no bus back, paddy wagon, nothing like that. Right? Bring him back, and then he's getting from them, you know, the intelligent tone letter or conversation. Having nothing to do with the passport. Right? Don't worry, you put it out there, don't worry. But it's a good, it's real good. It's a good one, trust me. Right? That the border people they give you a personal phone call, the personal call, right? With regard to the matter and stuff like that, you know, trust me. Right? This is a good one. No person shall be denied accommodation or be separated or segregated in any train, ship, motor vehicle, airship, trolley car, or other public conveyance because of color, race, or nationality. And no person shall be denied admission or equal service, nor shall anyone be segregated in any inn, hotel, restaurant, cafe, theater, music hall, or other place of public resort because of color, race, nationality, whether the accommodations be equal or not. Negro talking to Negroes, and they still don't want to understand what their birthright is. Why she mention nationality if she doesn't know what it is? Why are these people going to come together, right? Make this league for the struggle of Negro rights, talk about not being discriminated against based on nationality if they didn't know what nationality was. And that they obviously have one if they're going to mention it. It might not have anything to do with Negro, but obviously these people have a nationality that this league's talking to. Obviously they have a nationality if they're going to mention that they shouldn't be discriminated against because of a nationality or race, color, or whatever, you know, the frauds. But they have the legit thing in there that identifies these people. And the only nationality that they could be over here is African or more. Because, you know, African more synonymous. Because this is Africa, so you know, that's why. You know. Right? But there's some good ones in here. No person shall be charged higher or additional fees, prices, or rates of any kind of insurance on account of nationality, race, or color. This is Negro talking to Negroes, right? No person shall be charged higher or additional fees, prices or rates of any kind of insurance on account of nationality, race, or color. Okay? No person shall be deprived the right of appointment to any office or position, or the right to take any examination for any such office or position, or denied permanent appointment because of color, race, or nationality. See how much they mention nationality in this? No person shall be excluded from or discriminated against or segregated in the armed forces. Didn't they talk about in the armed forces, right? And then soldiers getting treated, you know, differently because their stuff, whatever. Okay, and majority of the people who were in those armies, the dark-skinned people, they identified themselves as Negro. But then, if there's this league right here that all Negroes should have known about, I mean, you know, they knew about the Scottsboro Boys, so they should know about this league, right? And the league is telling them about the struggle for Negro rights and what they have in place as far as a general policy, right? Because of this occupational force. And they put it out there, and then Negroes didn't buy into it. But it's giving them keys. Because remember, this is after Noble Drawley, right? That they're bringing up nationality. Still, you know, they're doing their best trying to keep it in the minds of the people. Not to drop the ball, because, you know, ball's already dropped. Profit's not here. So, let's see how much people we could get with this net. Because they're scattering right now. They're going back to, you know, voting for elephants and donkeys and stuff like that, thinking that they got some say or whatever. You know, oh, there goes the guy telling people capitalize N's on Negro and all that. So it's legit, so it could be recognized by the quote-unquote European, you know. Oh, no person shall be deprived the right to bear arms in self-defense, or to keep such arms in his home, or to use such arms by himself or in conjunction with others in defense of life by reason of nationality, color, or race. This is them talking to Negroes. Some other ones that you're gonna check out. In love, in time of cholera. In love, in time of cholera, by Gabriel Garcia Marquez, Marquez. An Island Beneath the Sea. Island Beneath the Sea. And that's a novel. Island Beneath the Sea. It's a novel, but remember, you know, there were other books that were novels that they made movies of, and, you know, Illuminati people got mad and stuff like that. So, not because it's a novel, don't think, you know, that it's fiction. Probably not fiction. So, Negro speeches you gotta check out. William Hamilton's speech. Right. William Hamilton's speech at the 4th Annual National Negro Convention. You hear some of these Negroes talk at their convention? 1834. 1887, Frederick Douglass, men of color to arms. Right. 1925, Henry Highland Garnett. An address to the slaves of the United States. And then you realize that, you know, you don't hear about these people that are speaking this constitutional perspective. We hear about them. You know, you gotta ask the question, you know, how come we don't hear about these guys? What's the issue? You know, that we don't hear about these people who are speaking so constitutional, right? Thomas Jessup. Through my operations, I have found the Negroes the most active and determined warriors. And during the conferences with the Indian chiefs, I ascertained they exercised an almost controlling influence over them. The Negroes rule the Indians. Right? You already know, you just do your research on Thomas Jessup. You already know the name. Brother Fletcher Majid said he came to the Old Fellows Hall at 33rd and State for the first time in the fall of 1933. The messenger told us about this white man, John Hawkins, and how he brought our forefathers here. He said that John Hawkins anchored his ship down on the Nile River. He was flying our flag. He was sailing the banks of the Nile River where our people were doing trade. Our flag was flying. Our flag was red for freedom, justice, and equality. When he got out to sea, they lowered our flag. The devils came together now that they have completed the making of the slave race. What shall we call them? The devils decided on the name Negro, which is derived from necro, and the Greek word necros, which means dead or dealing with the dead. The Good Tribe of Shabazz, the true story by Elijah Muhammad. So they know what's up. They not telling. And when they do tell, nobody's listening. And it's okay, you know, because all the documentation is there. I mean, we don't gotta, you know, recreate the wheel. You know, we don't gotta write speeches to try to convince these people that they're not Negro. Just point them to some Negroes that got a little education. You know, right? Just point to some Negroes that got a little education, and right. So, I close out today. All right, our close up today is the miseducation of the Negro, Carter G. Woodson. Some time ago, when Congressman Oscar DePriest was distributing by thousands copies of the Constitution of the United States, certain wiseacres were disposed to make fun of it. What purpose would such an act serve? These critics, however, probably did not know that thousands and thousands of Negro children in this country are not permitted to use school books in which are printed the Declaration of Independence or the Constitution of the United States. Thomas Jefferson and James Madison are mentioned in their history as figures in politics rather than expounders of liberty and freedom. These youths are not permitted to learn that Jefferson believed that government should derive its power from the consent of the governed. Not long ago, a measure was introduced in a certain state legislature to have the Constitution of the United States thus printed in school history. But when the bill was about to pass, it was killed by someone who made the point that it would never do to have Negroes study the Constitution of the United States. If the Negroes were granted the opportunity to pursue this document, they might learn to contend for the rights therein guaranteed, and no Negro teacher who gives attention to such matters of the government is tolerated in those backward districts. The teaching of government, or the lack of such instruction, then must be made to conform to the policy of keeping the Negro in his place. Right? So there you go. Negroes telling Negroes, study the Constitution, just like Noble Drew Ali said. Negroes telling Negroes that they have a nationality, just like Noble Drew Ali said. Negroes telling Negroes everything that they were supposed to be told. So when Noble Drew Ali came, they would be able to get down with the program immediately. It wouldn't even be a question to them. Immediately they would say, okay, yeah, I'm down with that. Right? So we still got work to do, Mars. Study, study, study. You already know how it goes. 9:04 right now. So you got about, you know, sorry I'm keeping y'all in class longer than, you know, I'm cutting your break time short. Because for some people, you know, y'all been going since 6 with Sabir. So it's just continuing it on. I know you only got a short break, you know, a 20-minute break instead of a half hour. So excuse me. But we're going to close out. Don't forget, Moores, rvbaypublications.com. Got any questions? CanaanLandGuide@gmail.com. Moorish Hip Hop. If you want to get some music from Iron Sheik, that's willofallah.com. As well, Moorish Civil Letter. MoorishCivilLetter.net. Etymology and the connection between Moors and masonry, etc. And remember that Noble Drew Ali told the Moors, if you could think, you're going to save yourself, right? And for the people who don't know, Eyes Wide Open, every Tuesday, blogtalkradio.com, MHHS-Eyes Wide Open. Call in number 347-945-5899. Islam to all the Moors worldwide. I think we had a record today. Mm-hmm. About 25 or something, 28, something like that. So word's getting out. 5 on the left, 2 on the right. Allah, the Father of the Universe, Father of love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice. Allah is my protector, my guide, and my salvation by night and by day through his holy prophet, Noble Drew Ali. Islam. Peace, Hotep. Much love, Moors. And as you know, 9:30, we'll connect again. Peace.